So yeah, help me kind of explain to me, or help me understand the why Howard Johnson's became so well known and so widespread. You know, you mentioned how it's like home cooking and good prices. Yes, was that it? Was that the basis of it, or is there more to it?
Well, there's more to it. When he started in 1925, he took a small loan from not only his widowed mother, but also Dr. George Dalton, who was an internist at Quincy City Hospital. And what he did was to purchase a corner store in Wollaston, which is a neighborhood of Quincy. And this was a corner store adjacent to a railroad depot, so people commuted to Boston. So not only did he sell cigarettes and cigars and newspapers and magazines, but he had a soda fountain. And he basically had three forms of ice cream, vanilla, chocolate, and strawberry. But the whole concept was Howard Johnson was really a far thinker. He was somebody who not only could actually think about the present, but he also thought of what he could possibly do in the future. And the ice cream, which was perfectly fine, was not homemade. So he began in some ways to not only produce a fine ice cream, initially through his mother's recipe and later, which he purchased for $300, which in 1926 was a tremendous sum of money, from a man by the name of William Halbauer, who had an ice cream stand in Nahant, Massachusetts. But he began to experiment with flavors. And though he became well known as the man who provided 28 flavors, something for every palate, he might have 35 on the menu at any given time. So it seemed in some ways, not only was he providing high quality premium ice cream, when the word premium probably didn't even come into an equation, but he was also beginning in some ways to offer fine food. And ironically, Howard Johnson's didn't just do baked macaroni and cheese and chicken croquet, but he also began in some of his more urban settings to provide filet mignon, short ribs, as well as even lobster tails. So he really did the gamut of not only food and ice cream, but he also in some ways trained all of his staff. And the idea here was that it wasn't just his staff, but as early as 1935, he began to franchise his restaurants.
Right.
And the franchise concept, of which he's called the father of the franchise industry, was something that not only created a cash flow, because it could cost anywhere from $3,000 to $4,000 at the height of the Depression, but he was also somebody who would oversee it, not only with a team of architects under his employ, but also purchasing land at very strategic locations, always at an intersection. But it was also something that he would then, through a commissary, sell the food to the franchisee. And in that way, not only could he standardize the food production, but he could also, in that instance, control the name. Because what they were doing, they were actually leasing the name of Howard Johnson's. And with his name there, one wanted to be sure that the, say, fried clams that one got in Bangor, Maine, were the same fried clams that you got in Miami, Florida. So through that franchise industry, he not only controlled quality control, but he also in some ways controlled the growth. And believe me, the growth between 1925 and 1975 was tremendous.
Hey, thanks for watching this video. This is my dog, Murphy, and these are dog treats. Now I'll give Murphy one of these dog treats, and all you have to do is press the like button. Just press that little like button right down there at the bottom of this video, and this sweet, adorable, cute little puppy gets a treat. All thanks to you. All right, you did it? Okay, I believe you. You said you did it. There you go, Murph. She got that treat because of you. Now, I'll eat one of these treats, and all you have to do is click that subscribe button right there, pointing to it. Just click that subscribe button, subscribe to Curiosityness with me, Travis DeRose. Get lots of good video, and I'll eat this treat. All right, you did that too? That's not very good. Bro, not very good.